Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Can everyone hear me? Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. I'm going to briefly talk about and show the slides of our recent pilgrimage in September to Mount Athos, the Holy Mountain, Agion Oros, as it's called in Greece. I was joined by our beloved priest, Father John, who I hope will lend some support to me, and my dear friend, Mitya Ryapsev, who was with me most of the time. We roomed together most of the time. And five others who, most of them are in the Slavonic liturgy this morning. And this presentation is actually one that was assembled by Nikita Zelensky. I'm going to address his slides. I'm not always sure what he wanted to say, but I'm going to address them as best as I can. The other members of the pilgrimage were Alex Zarichniak, for those of you who know him, and Misha Nazarets, and Alex's brother-in-law from New Jersey, Kolya Ignatovich, whom we met, most of us met for the first time. Am I forgetting somebody? Okay. As I said, it was four nights and about 4.5 days. We landed in Thessaloniki, which is the closest large city. I believe it's the second largest city of Greece. It's a thriving metropolis, and a very big contrast to what we encountered during our pilgrimage. And we were greeted there by our beloved guide, Father Vasily, who was with us most of the time during our pilgrimage on Mount Athos. He drove us from, and his helpers, he had a driver that helped him most of the time, from Thessaloniki to Uranopolis. Uranopolis is the staging point for most pilgrims who are entering the Holy Mountain. It's a port. You can see it on the top of the map there, the very far left on the top. Some of you may have already heard a little bit about this because Father Patrick Viscuso, who helped us plan the pilgrimage, also gave a talk, and so did Lazar, those of you who know Lazar, and Andrei Gidaspov, who's probably here somewhere, who gave an excellent talk. So I'm probably going to touch a lot of the same points you might have already heard about, but I'm going to try to give it a personal perspective and tell you what happened to us.
Please, Igor, don't forget Andrei Skurikin as well.
And of course, I knew I forgot somebody. And Andrei Skurikin, who met with us personally before we departed and gave us a lot of practical advice and told us things that we should expect and things that we should do, and we couldn't have done it without Andrei Skurikin's help either. So Mount Athos is a peninsula, as you know, and it's part of a region called the Chalkidiki, which is sometimes called the Three-Fingered Peninsula, and Mount Athos is actually the third of those three fingers that jut out into the sea. We set out on, after spending overnight in Uranopolis, which is a beautiful seaport, sort of a commercial. It's sort of, the economy depends on pilgrims, and all the businesses and restaurants and stores cater to pilgrims and offer icons. And I took some amusing pictures, you know, of storefronts that say, that were usually in Russian, Greek, and English. Russian was almost like the third language because everyone realizes there are a lot of Russian pilgrims that pass through and bring money to the economy there. I have a picture postcard just to show. You probably can't see it from here, but it's a beautiful beach, and there are boats that set off from there, and there are beautiful sunsets. And from some parts of Uranopolis, you can see the Holy Mountain. So if you look at the map, we'll just take a brief look at the map. We took the ferry from Uranopolis to Daphne, the port, which is the main port. I think Daphne and the capital city of Karies, which is inland, and you can see that also in black there, those are the only two large towns, the only places that have paved streets anywhere. along the way, the ferry also stops at some of the monasteries along that coast, along the western side there. And very impressive is our approach to St. Pantaleon, the so-called Russian monastery, Rosikon, which has traditionally been a Russian monastery. The thing I wanted to tell you about our ferry ride that was very, it seemed like almost some sort of providential sign. I'm not exactly sure what it signified or what it meant, was even though we started in beautiful weather, during the ferry ride, the weather started to become overcast and it started to drizzle, as you can see in the picture. And by the time we got to the port of Daphne, the skies started to open up and a torrential downpour that lasted most of the day started. And everybody there was amazed. We were told that there had been a long dry spell on the Holy Mountain and it hadn't rained for nearly 2 months or longer. So this was the first major rain they've had. And it wasn't just it started out as a drizzle on the ferry ride, but when we got to the port of Daphne, it really started to come down hard, and it was coming down very hard most of the time. And I'll show you a brief video of that, because people there, the monks, were so amazed that everyone was standing out and taking pictures and videos of it raining, because they haven't seen it rain so hard in a long time. Yeah, why don't you turn on the video? Most of the people had ducked into shops or cafes, anywhere that had shelter. As you can see, the streets were just overflowing with water, rivers of water coming down the streets. And poor Father Vasily had a very detailed itinerary planned for us that day, which apparently fell apart because a lot of the roads, most of the roads on Athos, as Father Patrick and Andrei knows, are unpaved and they're not very, very well kept. I mean, they're very rocky. They're hard to get over, and the roads were just flooded and impassable. So Father Vasily had to make some last-minute changes to our schedule. So we ducked into a cafe and had lunch here because there was nothing else we could do because it was raining so incredibly hard. And people say that everything that happens on Mount Athos, even more so than in the world, is by some sort of divine design. I don't know if this was some sort of sign or what it signified, but it was something that really made quite an impression on us.
What you can't see from those slides is that the water was actually 6 to 8 inches deep, and that flash flood occurred within the space of an hour and a half to 2 hours.
Right.
And basically, when we came into the town,
Louder.
When we came into the town, our driver had to drop us off at the doorway for the cafeteria because we could not walk through the waters to get to where we were going to eat. There was no way to walk, and people stood on the sidewalks and just waited for the rain to stop. So that truly is a torrential downpour, and it was quite deep, and it lasted a long time. But as Igor said, the monks were ecstatic because they had had no rain for months, and so this truly was a godsend for them. Not so much for us in that moment, though.
I don't know if I dare say something like this, but maybe it was some way that the Theotokos was welcoming us to the Holy Mountain. I don't know. And as Father John just now explained, the roads were impassable, so we had to make changes to our schedule. We wanted to do some things that were near. This is taken in the capital city of Karyas, which has paved streets. We wanted to do some things in the nearby vicinity, but we couldn't get through. We were spending our first night in Philotheo, so we decided to go directly there, but on our way, we were able to get to Iveron. Can we get to the next slide? Okay. Many of you might know the story of, and it's been probably repeated at previous talks about the Holy Mountain, of how many centuries ago, the Holy Theotokos, the Mother of God, landed on the island, it is said, with St. John the Evangelist. They were on their way to, I believe, Cyprus to visit St. Lazarus, who in the Gospels was risen from the dead, and a sea storm blew them off course, and they landed here. And since then, the Holy Mountain, this place, has been considered a special place, the Garden of the Theotokos. She is the protectress, the guardian of the monks here. And I think there are records of monastic communities being here from practically the 5th or 4th century, although most of the monasteries can trace back to around the 10th or 9th century, at least the modern versions of them. And here we see a picture. There are so much fruit, olive trees, lime trees, fig trees, grapes that grow on the vine, everywhere. So it truly was a garden. It was beautiful to look at. Our first stop, we stopped at Iveron. It was still a driving torrential rain when we got to Iveron. We can go to the next slide. Picture of the beautiful the coast, the rocky coast there. Nikita, who put these slides together, is something of an amateur botanist, and who along the way told us about some of the plants that we saw, and many of them which are edible, and all kinds of varieties of. It's very rich and green, beautiful island, a peninsula. I mean, and oh, can you go back to that other slide, the previous one? There you can see Athos in the background with the cloud perched on the top. And I can honestly say, the whole 4 days we were there, I never saw the top of Athos when it didn't have a cloud on top of it. It almost seemed like it was signified that the cloud on the top of the mountain signified that it was the protecting veil, the Pokrov, as they say in Russian, of the Mother of God. Sort of seemed to say that to me every time I looked at it. And it was just so beautiful, just so inspiring to look up at it and see the cloud on top of the mountain.
Igor, that was near enough, a perfectly clear day, no clouds at all.
Oh, really?
Sky,
oh.
And there was a cloud.
There was still a cloud. It seemed that way. And I remember the day we left, it was a beautiful sunny day, and there were no clouds anywhere, but there was a cloud on top of the mountain. Oh, I'm glad there's someone else who was a pilgrim there. Anyone who was a pilgrim there at any time can correct me. Just raise your hand if I say something wrong or if I butcher some Greek words, because I tried to learn some Greek as best as I could. I learned Yevcharisto, thank you, and Parakalo, and things like that. And I recognize certain Greek prayers, too. Okay, now we can continue, please. Our first night was at Philotheo Monastery. It was still raining when we got there, and shortly after we checked into the guest house, and as other pilgrims have noted before, when you arrive at a monastery as a guest, you're usually greeted with the customary signs of hospitality from the monks, which is the lukumi, the Greek delight, or in this country it's often called Turkish delight, the sweet Greek candy. Some Greek coffee, it's not called Turkish coffee there. Some Greek brandy called Siporo. And usually water, because it's easy to get thirsty when you're active and busy all day and become dehydrated, and they always offer water as well. So we went, after checking into the guest house, we went directly to Vespers. It was still raining, and by the time we left Vespers, the sun had emerged, and it was a beautiful day, and it stayed pretty nice most of the rest of the time we were there, although I was expecting hot weather, and it was fairly cool the 3 days, 4 days, 4 nights we were there. Philotheo Monastery, incidentally, at Philotheo and at Vatopedi, there are many prominent pictures and icons also. Even though he hasn't been, I don't believe he's been canonized by the Patriarchate of Constantinople. He's been sort of locally canonized. Elder Joseph the Hesychast, and one of his disciples is the well-known Elder Ephraim, who was the abbot of Philotheo Monastery and who founded the Monastery of St. Anthony in Arizona, which many of you know about. The monastery, I believe, was sort of revived in the 1970s. the state of monasticism, from what I understand, what I was told, was sort of declining in the 1970s with a very low number of monks. But in the 1970s, the numbers of monks started to increase again. All right, this is a well-known icon that we see during Lent usually, the icon of the ladder of divine ascent. And I'm not going to lecture about hesychasm. Maybe Father John would like to do that, but that's something that we're very much aware of when we're there. St. Gregory Palamas, as most of you know, was a bishop, I believe, at Thessaloniki, which is nearby, and he's associated with that. And the monks engage in this contemplative practice of inner silence, of prayer. After our stay at Filatheo, we moved on to Megisti Lavra, the Great Lavra. Father Vasily corrected me once. I translated that as Velikaya Lavra, because great is Velika, and he said, no, there's only one Velikaya Lavra, and that's Jerusalem. This is just a big lavra, he told me. It's one of the oldest, I think maybe the oldest monastery there, I'm not sure. And it was founded by Saint Athanasius, not to be confused by Saint Athanasius the Great, but this is Saint Athanasius the Athenite, who built the monastery and who supervised the construction of its main church, which is called the Catholicon in Greek, which was to be dedicated to the Annunciation, but he died while supervising its construction. He fell from the top of one of the construction areas and to his death. And so the Catholicon, the church, is now dedicated to him. On our way to the Great Lavra, we stopped at the spring of St. Athanasius, which has been flowing since he founded the monastery in the 10th century. It's a crystal clear, pure water, and we drank from it. And I don't remember exactly how the story about it goes, but the Mother of God directed him to where the water would be found, and I believe I have an icon that shows the Mother of God showing St. Athanasius where the source of the water is. This is the 1,000-year-old cypress tree that's right in front of the Catholicon, the main church. I was told that there's more than one of these cypress trees that St. Athanasius himself planted 1,000 years ago, and that they're all still there and alive. And this is the one right in front of the church. And as you can see, I have a picture of it with some of our pilgrims sitting underneath it. It's just very impressive. And that's the courtyard just to the right of the Catholicon. And one walks through the courtyard to go to the refectory, the trapeza, to have meals. And you can see behind it a structure called the Fiale, I'm not sure how it's pronounced, which is a large outfont. This is a semandron. I'm not sure what the difference between a talanton and a semandron is, but I can let you hear what it sounds like. They take some kind of hammer and beat it. It's the call to prayer. And some of the monks actually walk around with these big wooden things and walk around and beat on them as they're walking. This is a big one that's just stationary and it's beaten. And usually, once they start beating it, you know you better be on your way to service, because the service is not long after. As somebody once told me, you should probably be ready to be on your way to the service before you actually even hear the beating of the talanton. And sometimes we were. I was with the crazy American Russians, as some of us called it, who sometimes showed up even before the monks, I think. I don't know, because we were so nervous about being late. We spoke Russian most of the time, although we tried to translate for poor Father John, because our guide, Father Vasily, did not speak English. So it was sort of, we were identified as both being Russians and Americans. We were trying to explain to people that we were Russian Orthodox, but from the US. On our return, after we spent one night at Megisti Lavra, we headed back up the east coast of the peninsula, and we couldn't stop at the Iveron spring of the at the Iveron monastery because it was raining so hard there. So we stopped there and drank from the spring. As it says there, it's only 15 meters from the sea, and I believe I've added a few of my own personal pictures at the end of Nikita's presentation to show you. I think you can see how close the sea is. The spring came forth from the spot where the famous Iveron icon appeared from the sea, the Portatisa, the gatekeeper. And it's been flowing ever since. And the amazing thing about it is crystal clear, pure, somewhat cold water, but it's completely, it's not salty, even though it's next to the sea. It's just no salt, no sign that it's anywhere near the sea, but it's very close to the sea. The next monastery we stayed at was Vatapedi, which is also dates from 1,000 years ago. And there we also saw prominent pictures of Elder Joseph, the Hesychast. It's a very thriving monastery with monks from all over the world. The first two monasteries, Megisti Lavra and Philotheo, we encountered sometimes monks that spoke a little English or Russian, but mostly everyone spoke Greek. But here we could find more English and Russian speakers. Very often, I would accidentally start speaking Russian, and I would find they would be able to answer me. It was often so dark, as a matter of fact, that you'd stumble around in the dark, and the monks wear these black robes. I remember bumping into a monk and saying in Russian, "Prastichi," and thinking, "Oh, how do you say that in Greek?" And he said, "Nichuwa," something to that effect. He responded in Russian. This is the refectory, the trapeza, where we had meals. The monks were very generous at their meals, especially for the pilgrims. At Vatapedi, we found that because they had such a great number of monks, they were very much aware of us and were treated as honored pilgrims, and they always told us to go to the front of the line for trapeza and reserved a table specially for us in many cases. Father John was usually ushered to the table with where clergy and monastics were. And this is one of the monks preparing the meals for us. The meals were very good. As you know, they don't eat meat. On Saturday and Sunday, we had some fish. Usually they're whole fish that you have to pick through. We often had bean soup. We had a lot of fresh vegetables and fruits from the peninsula. Olives grow everywhere. Nikita actually encouraged me to eat an olive right from the tree, but as of course, as you know, an olive that's not that's processed, it doesn't taste very good if you eat it right from the tree. And they grow their own tomatoes and other fruits, and they serve it there. And during the weekend, we also had wine. I remember at Megisti Lavra, we were there on a Friday when the monks usually fast, but they did prepare a breakfast for us as the pilgrims there. This is a group shot. It was taken by Misha Nazarets. That's why he's not pictured there. This is one of the smaller monasteries we stopped at, traveling along the eastern coast from Megisti Lavra to Vatapedi. The two we stopped at were Karakalu, which is dedicated to Saint Peter and Paul, and Stavro Nikita, which is dedicated to Saint Nicholas and has a miracle working icon of Saint Nicholas. Stavro Nikita, I believe, is considered the smallest of the 20 monasteries on the Holy Mountain, and it had a very small Catholicon, you could tell when we walked into it, with a small number of monks. Karakalu also was not very big, but they stand in commanding spots right on the rocky coast there. This is an icon, not an icon, but this is in front of the Pantaleimon Monastery, the Russian monastery, Rosikon. It's called Rosikon because it's known as the Russian monastery. And this is a picture of a well-known event that happened there in 1903. There was a photograph taken following a service in 1903 by one of the monks, I believe his name was Gabriel, at the gate near the church. And when the photograph was developed, there was a woman pictured in it. And it could only have been, as the monks say, the Holy Mother of God who appeared miraculously. And this is you probably can't see it from way back there, but this is the actual photograph. And it's been made into icons. And the Russian Orthodox Church has actually put it on the Menaean as a feast day. It's recognized, I believe, since 2013, the Synod of the Russian Orthodox Church has a feast day dedicated to the miraculous appearance of the Mother of God in 1903 at St. Pantaleimon. While we were there, we did not spend much time at St. Pantaleimon, the Russian monastery, because there was an enormous influx of Russian pilgrims to celebrate the 1,000th anniversary of St. Pantaleimon, of its founding. And recently, its abbot, the 101-year-old Jeremiah, had passed away, and they were also electing a new abbot. He wasn't elected, I believe, until after we departed. So it was very hard to get into the monastery, but Father Vasily, through his efforts, managed to get us in for a few hours on the day we left on that Monday morning. And we saw there is no photography allowed, we discovered to our chagrin after we entered the monastery. It was a sign that clearly said that. So we started taking pictures right away, and then we realized we weren't allowed.
Right there. So, yeah. If I may.
Please.
One thing that Igor didn't touch on was the fact that all of these monasteries are basically walled, enclosed communities. And this picture was taken of one of the exit and entry gates for Filotheou. But it was remarkable to me, and I know that we talked about this as well, that in particular, when we went to Stavno Nikita, which Igor talked about as being the smallest of the monasteries, as you approach, there are a series of canals and gardens. But when you get to the entry to the monastery itself, it's got these very big, very heavy banded iron doors. And there were a number of dents in those doors. And we asked about that. And we were told by the monks that these communities were walled and gated because they had been subjected to hundreds of years of pirate invasions. And so what we were seeing at those gates was musket fire. And we saw the dents from these gates as they withstood the pirate invasions. And so if you go to any of these monasteries, you'll notice that they're all enclosed. The dwellings are typically on the outer perimeter, and we were nervous looking at these houses. If you look around the perimeter, they've got what in many cases look to be very insubstantial beams of plywood holding them up as they're overhanging the land beyond. But all of them were arranged in this way, and so you would walk in the entry gate, and there was a guest house on that inner gate, but all of them were situated such that the perimeter was the living quarters, and the center portion was where people would come to worship. But that was for a practical reason, because in addition to serving God and doing everything that monasteries do, they also had to, on more than one occasion, defend themselves against the pirates that were seeking the treasures that they had within their walls.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. And that was also noticeable at Magisti Labra. I have a picture of us walking around. It looks like it's a heavily fortified monastery. And Magisti Labra is right at the southern tip, which is easily accessible from the sea and was often invaded by pirates as well. Now, that's why I believe that, missing some of the slides that Nikita had. One of them was an icon of the Panagia Paramithia, the icon of consolation.
Oh.
Yeah, there are some of them. Yeah, these are some of the ones we missed. All right, prayer. This is the icon of the Panagia Paramithia, which I believe some people in slang refer to it as the shushing icon. And there's a story which I'm often told that I don't relate stories very accurately, but I'm going to give you the rough version. This is an icon that's a very treasured icon at Vatapedi Monastery, which was also often invaded by pirates from the sea. And also, it was an incident incursion from the Latins too. But during one of the invasions from pirates, the monks were praying before this icon, and they heard a voice from the Mother of God telling them to go up to the walls and not to open the gates to the pirates. And why people sometimes call this the shushing icon is because Christ was angry at the monks because they had been observing the monastic rules and the monastery was going to decline. They weren't behaving well. So the Mother of God said that to go up to the walls, not to open the gates to the pirates, but to show repentance because my son is angry with you for being sinful. So this is the icon, and the icon actually changed with the hand of the Christ child raised up, shushing the Mother of God, who then instructed the monks to show repentance because my son is angry with you. So this is the icon of consolation. It's very, very venerated. There are long lines, and when we were at Vatapedi, we, and this was after going up the coast on a very grueling day, visiting other monasteries and shrines and springs, and we arrived there to a service that started at around 4 vespers, and the matins didn't conclude until around 1 a.m., although we did break for 2 or 3 hours for trapeza and for a guided tour when we were allowed to venerate this icon. And there are other sacred relics. I have lists here, but I can't find all the lists of which sacred relics were where. But I know that at Filotheo, I believe that the right hand of St. John Chrysostom, and at Vatapedi is the skull of St. John Chrysostom with the incorrupt ear. You can actually see his ear. And after services, that there's usually a short pause when all the relics are brought out from where they are safely stored. And they're brought out for the pilgrims to venerate. And they're placed on tables. Their tables are brought forth in front of the altar, and you go in front of them. And what I didn't know was people actually give their prayer robes to the monks attending the relics, and they're brushed against the relics. And I was looking and not understanding what was happening, and the monk looked at me in frustration and said, "Anyone here Orthodox?" And then I finally figured it out, and I did have a prayer rope, and I gave it to him.
So can you tell us what that prayer is there?
Oh, and I put that prayer there because that's the Jesus prayer in Greek, and forgive me if I don't say it correctly. Kyrie Jesu Christei tu Theo eleison me ton amartolon. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And when we first stopped at Iberon, I got a little, I think it's actually a refrigerator magnet, but it's a piece of wood with the prayer in Greek. And I got it to help me through all the lengthy Greek services where I didn't, and probably some of you who have to stand through Slavonic services and don't understand this can relate to this experience. And I tried to follow the services as best as I could. But Father Vasily gave me a good piece of advice. If you don't know what's happening, say the Jesus prayer. Try to learn it in Greek. And that's why I had that with me. I actually had it in my hands more than my prayer rope, because if I felt my mind was starting to wander and I couldn't focus on the service and I was just so exhausted that, you know, it was a marathon service that lasted from the afternoon to the early morning and the early morning, I felt like I was collapsing. So I said the Jesus prayer as often as I could. And then there is actually a funny story. When I arrived at Vatapedi, I felt close to collapse. I just couldn't barely even stand up anymore. And the monks, they don't, they let the pilgrims worship in peace, but they know we're there, they're aware of us, and they try to help us whenever they can. And one of the monks noticed me and noticed that I was falling apart. And I thought I had gotten in trouble because he walked up to me and he motioned for me to come out. I thought I had done something wrong. And that's how sinful I am, I have to admit. And this is a monk trying to show me compassion and trying to help me instead, you know. And he told me, what's wrong? Are you okay? Should I call a medic to help you? And also he noticed that I was scratching myself when I was at Megisti Lavra. And I didn't realize it until later. I hardly slept at all, and I couldn't figure out why. It was because I was being bitten by bed bugs. And I had bed bug bites all over my arms and all over my legs. And while I was talking to him, I was scratching the whole time. And I was told that one or two of the other pilgrims also had bed bug bites and were advised to put some of the holy myrrh that some of us had gotten at Vatapedi on it. It would help.
Can I add one thing to what you said?
Sure.
I don't know that Egan, and I want to do a sidebar here, because Egan was our historiographer. He was our encyclopedia for all things Mount Athos while we were on the trip, and his giving us the background began as we were taking that ferry ride over from Oranopoli. He was just a wealth of information. It was obvious that he had prepared himself ahead of time, and this is exactly why he is giving this presentation, because I think of all of us, he was the most prepared to fully experience the Holy Mountain. And that was a blessing not just for him to have all of that information, but it was a wealth of information for all of us as well. So as you're giving the presentation, I would like to thank you also for being that source, that font of information for all of us. It was wonderful. But one thing that Edith did not convey, I think, in its fullness was the scale of the relics. So he mentioned that we would go for the Vesper service, and then there would be a break, and they would go into different services depending upon which monastery we were at. So there may have been small compline, it may have been a paraklesis to the Mother of God. The service depended upon the monastery that we were at, but invariably, in all the monasteries that we stayed in, between those two services, as the pilgrims were heading to the refectory for the meal, the pilgrims would begin to put up these long tables. And we were just looking at them, wondering, why are they putting these tables up in the center of the church? And we found out, of course, in Philotheo, when we came back from the meal, it was to have these relics out. But the reason that I asked for the mic is because Egan has talked about one or two substantial relics, but every single relic that they put on the table was a true relic. We're used to small relics and bits of mastic. You know, we're used to the composite little collections of relics that are very small and very self-contained. What I certainly wasn't prepared for was the fact that we were venerating entire forearms, or as Igor touched about, entire skulls with intact ears. Every relic was like that. They were all truly life-size. And I think that it's easy for us to take for granted that the relics that we venerate in church were actually once, in many cases, part of a saint that participated in God's grace, but that really was driven home when you are venerating things that are recognizable as pieces of a human being. And understanding when you have access to their lives, when you have access to the historical reality of what they did when they walked on this earth, to be able to venerate something that is truly life-size, that to me was one of the things that I will never forget about the Holy Mountain. It really drove home what it means to be a saint. And the other thing that I would add to that is, you know, forgive me for the theological sidebar here, but we're all called upon to be saints. And this is something that the monks spoke to us about, that saints are not just those who walked with Christ and then died and were glorified by the church. If we go back and read the scriptures, St. Paul refers to those who are among the living as saints. And more than one monk spoke to me and said, don't simply venerate these and give honor to those who have passed away. Take to heart what they meant and try to live as they lived, so that you might be a saint while you're still alive. And that was one of those small gems that I took away from the Holy Mountain, that we're called to be saints not after we die, but we're called to be saints in this life. And that's what the monks were to us. They were this living presence of what it meant to live a life that was fully dedicated to Christ. And that was another one of the takeaways that hopefully I never forget, but it was one of the great blessings of being on the Holy Mountain as well.
Very well said, Father. I think that icon of the ladder of divine descent, probably Nikita had something along the lines of what Father John just said to accompany that slide about the monks being working towards sainthood just like we should. And it's an amazing thing. One thing that Nikita and Alex and many of us have noted, that during the services, the monks who are sort of like angels dressed in black that seem to float around. It almost seems like choreographed. They just know exactly where they're going and where to go, and they just seem to float through the church like angels. And very often, you know, the matin starts at either at 3:30 or 4, and we wake up at 3 o'clock, and it's pitch black, and we can't see anything. And as I already said, it was very easy to bump into these black-robed monks. Since I just talked about waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning, we became acquainted with the concept of Byzantine time. The day actually starts in the evening of the previous day, and we were often told that the time isn't the same here as it is in the world. And we felt very much that we were not in the world the whole time we were there, and Father John brought this up to me in private discussion, because of it's so, for one thing, it's so dark and there's very little illumination, and the service starts in pitch dark, and you're walking around at night trying to find where the church is, and you can see a beautiful sky with the constellation and the stars that you can't see here. And the other thing is the feeling of silence everywhere. It's like once we left the Holy Mountain, we could feel that going away, and that special feeling that you get when everything is completely silent. It's something that you really feel when you're there, and then you could feel a holy presence that way. As you can see, matins starts, and sometimes there's a liturgy after the matins, then there's a trapeza afterwards, then the monks go to their work. And Father Petty, we got a beautiful, wonderful tour of the sacristy, I believe it was called, where the Father Petty has a great number of priceless treasures. We were given a special tour along with another group from the United States. I believe they were Greek Americans. And Father Matthew is an American monk at Vater Petty, who spoke with us on our last evening and told us a lot of interesting things. And we were glad to meet him and get to know him a little bit. And we didn't sleep very much, and it seemed like we didn't eat very much. And I don't know how we were being propelled. It was just through prayer, I think, through most of the time we were there. This is our beloved guide, Father Vasili, who I grew really to love. And he was like a patient and tolerant parent. And like most monks, he did not talk a lot, because monks don't speak superfluously. They don't engage in small talk. But when he did talk, it was always something that made a deep impression on me. I already told you about how he advised me to recite the Jesus prayer, and I tried to do it in Greek as much as I could when I thought I was near collapse and I couldn't concentrate anymore. Another thing, and this is relates to why I call him a patient and tolerant father, we were often, as Alex liked to say, more like spiritual tourists, because we were just so overwhelmed by the beauty of everything we saw. Our first inclination was to take pictures and to look at everything almost like tourists. And he told me once, first you pray, and then you take pictures. So I tried to do that as best as I could. And very often, I would get, and I was guilty of this, perhaps others of us were also guilty of this, I would lag behind, and I would be looking at things while everyone else moved on. And he would look at me with a smile curled on his lips, and he wasn't really angry, but here you're dragging again. You would look at me like a patient, tolerant father. He was a very loving man. And the last thing he told us was, when we parted with him, is, do you have any advice for all of us? And he said, to love one another. That's what he said. After we returned to the world, we went, before on our way back to Thessaloniki from Uranopolis, we stopped at the house of this dear woman, Jana. She's a young woman, but she is actually a grandmother. She has two adult children, believe it or not, because she was married off at the age of 13. She comes from the Russian North Caucasus. And she is the sweetest woman, so full of Christian faith. This is her house, and she showed us her icon corner. Her icon corner is not a corner. It's an entire room that's completely covered with icons. And you could just feel how imbued with faith she is. And she is poor and struggling to get along, and she wanted to give us this lavish feast with Russian food because she knew we were Russian Orthodox. She didn't make very much Greek food, mostly Russian food. She actually goes by the name Greek name Ioania, but we called her Jana and called her by her Russian name. And this is we were treated to a big. After not eating that much, I mean, the monks gave us good food, but this is the first big meal we had after we got back, and it was too much food that we couldn't even eat it all. And afterwards, before this, we also visited a nearby women's monastery, St. Anastasia. She lives near the monastery. Unfortunately, the relics of St. Anastasia, which used to be located there, were stolen, and they're no longer there. They were recently stolen. I want to again thank Father Victor for blessing our pilgrimage, and to Lazar Aliyev, who talked to us, Andrei Gidaspov, who talked to us and also gave excellent presentations, probably better than mine, Andrei Skurichi, who met with us personally and gave us a lot of advice, and Father Patrick Viscuso and his friend John Girakis, who also met with us personally and told us a lot of things that we needed to know. And we are very grateful to them because we wouldn't have known the first thing about what to do. Especially getting the Diamantarian, which is the pilgrim's visa that you need. And we weren't sure we were actually going till we got it. There's a pilgrim's office in Uranopolis that you had to stop at. And lo and behold, we got it. We saw some pilgrims who turned away who didn't get theirs. But we largely through the efforts and the help of those who guided us here, and Nikita and Alex, who persisted that we got our visas. This is a group shot taken at the Spring of St. Athanasius. It's Alex, Misha, Kolya Ignatovich, and Mitya. This is the dome at the Prodromos, the skit of St. John the Baptist, which is a dependency of the Great Lavra. It's probably the most beautiful skit we saw. We spent a lot of time there, that beautiful iconography everywhere. And we took a hike on the grounds. The grounds were very beautiful all around. But this is just an example of, you can see St. John the Baptist there painted on the roof. On the ceiling, I meant. This, I believe, is this the spring of the Iveron spring, I think, maybe. But Mitya usually was the one who helped us get our cups and fill them for us. And this is taken in front of the 1,000-year-old cypress tree, Nikita and Mitya, who posed for me there. And that's the font in the courtyard between the trapeza and the Catholicon. These are the fortified walls of Megisti Lavra, the Great Lavra. We were hiking around them one evening before going to bed. This is the icon of St. Athanasius discovering the spring with the help of the Mother of God who directed him there. That is, I captured Mitya at a bad moment there. That's in front of the... There you could see the sea is right there. And the doorway pictured there shows where the well is. As you can see, it's just a stone's throw away. This is the reliquary of St. Andrew the First called at Panteleimon, the Panteleimon Church at Panteleimon Monastery. We were allowed to take pictures there. However, this is at St. Andrew, forgive me, St. Andrew's Ski. at St. Andrew's Church at St. Andrew's Ski, which is a Russian-style church. And we were allowed to take pictures there. And Father Vasily, who always tried his best to get us everywhere and to let us see everything, tried to find the monk who had the keys to the reliquary so we could take the relics out, but unfortunately failed. At least he got the cover taken off the reliquary. When we first saw it, I think it's in a subsequent picture, that the reliquary still had its cover on it. So we just venerated the cover at first, then we venerated the reliquary, but we couldn't venerate the actual relics of St. Andrew, which I believe probably Andrei Skurikhin and Andrei Gidaspol did, perhaps. Since they're both named Andrei, I'm sure they wanted to do that. This is Axion Estin, it is truly meat, which we all know, Dostoyna Yesh in Russian, which was, according to the story, this the icon, there is a story, and of course I don't relate stories very well, an icon a long time ago, in the early days of Athos, a monk in the early days of Athos was praying evening service, and a stranger appeared at his door, and he prayed that it is truly meet with him, and then the monk asked him, he didn't know who he was, if you could tell him the words to that prayer, and he inscribed it on a tile. It was just, I don't remember how it happened, but in some miraculous fashion, the words appeared on the tile. And then I believe later, at some point, this tile was brought to Constantinople. But the icon in front of which he prayed, the Axion Estin, it is truly me icon, is in the Prototon Church in the capital city of Akarias. And we got to venerate it and pray before it. There are always a long line of pilgrims. It's almost like an assembly line, always people standing in line to venerate this icon. We were not allowed to take pictures inside the church or pictures of the holy icon, of course. The Prototon Church is so called because the Protos, who's the elder of the monastic community for the entire holy mountain, they meet there in the capital city to discuss administrative issues, I imagine.
It's customary to begin the journey there, is it not? Could you speak a little bit about what happened to us because of the raid?
Oh.
So we were supposed to kick off.
We were supposed to start at the Prototon. As I said, because of the raid, our itinerary and schedule had changed completely. We were supposed to go into the Prototon Church and to venerate the Axion Estin icon. But when we got there, and we had to go through rain, and there were some pictures of us holding umbrellas as we were walking to the church. The church was closed down for lunch hour or something, I don't remember why, but it wasn't there, so we had to return to it on our way back. And also on our way back, we visited the cell that Father Vasily is constructing. I think that's in the next slide. Oh, this is a picture I took on top of a cliff near Vatoteni Monastery, which you can see in the background here. We walked along the beach, a beautiful beach. We dunked our feet in the water, and this was after Sunday liturgy. Sunday liturgy, incidentally, was in Slavonic, because there was a visiting bishop from Samara. He celebrated the liturgy in Slavonic. However, the choir sang the responses in Greek, as I recall. And after the liturgy, we went for this walk up to the cliffside where the monks of Vatopedi had withstood incursion of Latins who tried to get them to renounce Orthodoxy, but the monks at Vatopedi refused, and they were, I believe some of them were hanged and some of them were drowned in the sea from this spot. So there is a cross marking the spot where they had perished. I believe the abbot's name was Euphemius. He was executed on the spot. And there's a chapel there now, too. The chapel was not open when we got there, but we met a visiting Russian Orthodox priest from the States, Father Andrei Sommer, as we were there, who also walked over after the liturgy. And we had a nice talk with Father Andrei, who's going to be at our church for the St. Herman's Conference in December. This is, as we were leaving, this is my shot. I think Nikita had also had a shot of the St. Panteleimon Russian Monastery, which we visited the St. Panteleimon Church before we left. We just had time to do that and nothing else. And very kindly, older monk gave us a tour of the St. Montalemin Church. And he related especially well to Mitya Ryabtsev, because he and Mitya both recited Russian poetry together, as I recall. He was sorry that the younger generation isn't educated as well as the older generation is, and that can't recite things from memory. And Mitya proved him right by being able to recite from memory, as I recall. I hope I didn't embarrass you by relating that story, Mitya. But he was a very kindly monk, and we were glad we got the personal tour of the church from him. This is in Thessaloniki. We said we wanted to venerate the relics of St. Demetrius in Thessaloniki. In this church, which I believe had burned down to the ground at the beginning of the 20th century and was completely rebuilt. And there was some kind of service going on, and the church struck me somehow sort of very Western. I don't know if it's biased, but after being in Athos, it just wasn't as impressive. But I was very glad, very happy we all were to venerate the relics of St. Demetrius when we were there. And that was the last thing we did before we parted with our dear, beloved Father Vasili. And let's see if we can have some shots of his. This is a picture I took as we were traveling to Vatopedi of the coast. And that's a picture in front of the church in the Lavra, of pilgrims. This was at the prodromos, St. John the Baptist. Nearby, there is a Ukrainian, and this is Father Nikola. Father Nikola is a Ukrainian monk who is also building his own ski, just like Father Vasili is. And he expended a lot of effort, and he built something that looks almost like a condominium that you would find in Maryland. It's very nice. It's not very primitive at all, but he intends a lot of monks to live there with him eventually. And he was selling some prayer ropes and things to help finance it. Its construction appeared to have been just finished recently. And behind you see the icon, which you see everywhere on the Holy Mountain, of the Holy Mother of God, Theotokos, as protectress of the monks there. This is the skeet, which amazingly Father Vasili is building. I believe he is formally attached to the Kutlumush Monastery, which is near to Karyas, but he has a blessing from that monastery to start his own skeet, and he's building it. I mean, he gets occasional help, and we asked him how he's financing it, and he's just collecting euros here and there wherever he can, and he builds it a little bit at a time, and we were very impressive at how far he's gotten. He gets some help, but he's supervising it, and it's a superhuman achievement, it seems to me. There's a chapel inside and many rooms, and he was showing what he envisioned for it in hopes to have monks to have this is what one thing I learned with the K words for Kalyan. Kalya is a cell, and there's also other different words for different monastic dwellings. I think kalivas, not kalivo, but kalivas is also a hut in Greek. And I believe some of the seaside cliffs are near the Great Lavra are called Karulia. I think so, it's also called the Hesychasterion, perhaps, where they live as hermits, completely separated from everybody. But this is a kalia, where other monks are intended to live. It's a small monastic community. And this is Father Vasili's garden. Nikita and I are admiring his garden. He has, incidentally, about 17 cats, which help keep the pests away, which he says includes snakes and scorpions. The cats love to eat scorpions, he says. But they feed them also. He grows figs. I actually ate figs from the tree, as I said, and grapes. He grows everything he needs there. And he served a lavish lunch to us while we were there that Saturday afternoon. He was very hospitable. These are the gates to the prodromos, St. John the Baptist skeet. As you can see, Father Vasili is looking at me patiently. He's like, why are you lagging behind again, Igor? And there is Misha and Nikita standing there with him at the gates waiting for me. And you can see the beautiful, beautiful mosaic of St. John the Baptist over the gates of the monastery. And this is as we were walking around, we took a hike in the vicinity, and you could see the holy Mount Athos in the background and the clouds at the top there. I think that's it. Sorry if it took so long. Any questions that maybe Father John can answer if I can't?
It seems to me when I look at schedule in the monastery, it's like they going to bed at 22, right? At 10 and waking up at 3 of this supposed to. So is it their regular schedule 5 hours of sleep?
I think so. I heard somewhere that monks, probably because of their lifestyle, how they lead their lives, they don't sleep a lot. They don't need a lot of sleep. Although we noticed that when we first, after the matins at Philotheo Monastery, when we tried to find the abbot or someone to give our offering to in the morning, one of the monks who met us said that the monks were all asleep. So I think some of them were taking a nap after matins. I'm not sure. Perhaps they take short naps, but most of them are probably at work.
So, and Saint Patilimonis Monastery, it's a Russian-style monastery.
It's a Russian-style monastery with great numbers of Russian pilgrims there. And it looks very Russian, and I think they conduct a lot of the services in Russian. And we actually met a parishioner from St. John's while we were there. I don't remember his name.
Alexander,
yeah.
He goes there once a year.
He goes there once a year, and he happened to be there just the same day we were.
And ladies not allowed to be near.
Ladies are not allowed. We noticed when we were in Neuronopolis that there are special tours for the ladies the men leave behind. They get to, the boat has to be not come to shore, but it can go around the peninsula and look at the monasteries from the sea.
I heard from the Athos, right?
Mm-hmm.
The ladies can stay on the ship and just
right.
Meet the monks.
They can wait for the
monks.
One of the slides Nikita had was showing that the ban on women dates from around 11th century sometime. And I think in the early days, perhaps there were female pilgrims, but it's enforced now. In spite of perhaps pressure from the European Union, which I think provides funds to maintaining it.
How old are the monks? Do they have a younger generation?
Yeah, there is a younger generation. As I said, during the 1970s, the population of monks was starting to decline, and there's been a sort of a renaissance, a growth in the number of monks there. So, as I said, at Vada Pedi, there are more than 120 monks from all over the world. There's a lot of monks and a lot of talented and well-educated monks who are contributing greatly to the flowering, the blossoming of the Holy Mountain.
Father Stephanos was fairly young, was he not?
Yeah. Oh, yes. At Vada Pedi. Yeah.
Can you talk about the children's school at Vada Pedi as well?
Maybe you can. I don't remember very much about it. Incidentally, there was a nice Australian monk that we talked to who reminded us a little bit the way he spoke, Father Alexander.
So one thing that I noticed when we were at Vada Pedi is we were waiting for the liturgy to start the next to the last day that we were there. I saw what I thought were a lot of little monklets, as I called them, kind of running around. These were boys that were 10 or 12 years old. And it turns out that when Father Matthew gave us the tour of the sacristy, he talked about the fact that Vada Pedi had a long history of educating young men on the Holy Mountain, but that the school was destroyed and went inactive for a number of years, and it was reinstated in the late 20th century. And so these boys, and I actually talked to one of the priest monks as the pilgrims were in church, but the boys come largely from disadvantaged homes where they might not get an education otherwise, and they're educated not just on secular subjects, but they're also educated in the life of the church as well. And we saw lots of these young men not only in the church and running around the grounds, but we also saw them in the refectory as well. And they were part of the younger generation. Many of these young men will grow up to embrace the monastic life as well. Yeah.
Thank you, Father.
What was the impression about singing, church singing?
Oh, well, as you know, we're not used to Byzantine chant. The best singing, in my opinion, was at Vada Pedi, it starts sort of as a low monotone and sort of increases, intensifies during the course of the service. And they had some style, correct me if I'm saying something ignorant, some sort of canonarchical singing that was going on at Vatapedi. There was a right kleros choir and a left kleros choir, and there was a canonarch who would go from the left to the right, to the left to the right.
They
added all of them. Oh, they added all of them, but I noticed it more, I think because I enjoyed the singing the most at Vatapedi, where I thought the singing was really good. I got to appreciate Byzantine chant a lot more. Thank you.